Welcome to the video. For those of you who are watching this channel for the first time, well, this is what I call phase four practice. This is what we're doing here, phase four practice. It's the final phase before realization, actually. It brings us to realization. It's, if you haven't done phase one, two, and three, it's too difficult to do. But if you have, then you're going to, you know, get it. What we do here is we take our time and we're working towards a stupendous staggering of the mind, which really means a stupendous staggering of our belief system. So we build up momentum, and at some point you will feel, you'll be aware, like, wow, this is just, it's a quantum jump, you know, beyond my belief system. And it's that point where you, certainly when you feel this, just full stop right there. Full stop in this burn, the stupendous staggered mindness. And this is called moving our comfort zone. We do this over and over and over, and we keep getting, going further and further and closer and closer and closer to non-dual realization. Vision of oneness. We get closer and closer and closer to the vision of oneness by gradually moving our comfort zone like this. It's a discipline, it's an ordeal, it's meditation, it's contemplation, it's spiritual practice. So this is like coaching for coaching spiritual practice, especially here, phase four. Phase one is when you realize that something's wrong. I mean, you feel like, you know what? I have a feeling that I need to start inquiring what's really going on. What's the situation? What's the body, world? I feel out of whack, and I feel that something's wrong. It needs to be, my relationship with God's out of whack somehow. Phase one. And you start, that it takes a while, phase one, for sure. Maybe many lifetimes. Phase two is when you then start to really change your belief system. Start to change your belief system. First step is, as my belief system is messed up. And then, but I'm not really sure what to do about it. Magical solutions, this and that. But I know something isn't right. Phase two is you start changing your belief system to truth. You really start realizing, wow, I got to redo this. Remodel your house. Remodel your belief system. Phase three, I found that what it was I spent the last 20 years examining my valuing of the world. Okay, intensely examining my valuing of this world. And working on so many, many, many different angles on this. I noticed, for instance, in this video of the Dzogchen master, and everybody's coming there and they're so excited and it's so great. And I said, okay, this is great. But then there's this feel I got about it. I said, okay, what's going on? And I realized that the people, okay, were stage struck. They're stage struck. Okay. So this is an example of examining your value in the world is like what I did. I went through all this stuff about being, you know, stage struck, worked on this, like, you know, the backdrop, the setting, the guru's there, is up there, is talking, and this is tents, and there's pavilions, and there's posters, and there's people, and there's all spiritual dress, and it's you know, it's like, wow, look at this production. And there's a certain kind of like stage struckness. People are saying, like, wow, I want to be up there. This is really cool. You know, like someone who, you know, is stage struck by movie stars and starlets and all this kind of stuff. So in phase three, you work through that. You work through that. It's very intense, very difficult, actually. It's not a phase I want to go through again. None of phase one, two, and three, no way. Very difficult. Very intense. But at this point, I don't really feel stage struck. It doesn't matter who shows up. It doesn't matter what the setting is, what the backdrop is. All I've worked on it so much. It just, who cares? It doesn't matter what your spiritual dress is, you know, and all this cool stuff, whatever you want to do. I did so much stuff, and it's been 20 years, and occasionally I still keep working on it, you know. I watched this video, for instance, of this wonderful video, incredible video, of this man who walks through cities, and he walked through Varanasi in India, and that was really mind-blowing. It was really a mind-blower. it does a great job. And just, it's like you're walking. What way does it feel like? You feel like you're taking this walk, and it's just like, oh my God. You know, look at this labyrinth. Look at this place. He walks along the Ganges, and then he starts cutting up through the town, and it's just surreally incredible. You know, the staging of that place, it's you can understand how you could be stage struck there. The Ganga and the Varanasi and the people, and it's just like, whoa. But in watching it, you know, you say, okay, and you gradually get used to it, and you wear off this whole stage struckness of spirituality, of this world of spirituality, the valuing of this world, even the spiritual world, no longer is attractive, really. At least greatly, greatly diminished. And so, unless there is something that is truly staggering, stupendous stagger of my mind, I don't care. Forget it. No matter what the staging is, you can have all the flowers. I mean, you know, so much, like walking through flower markets, videos of people going through these incredible flower markets. The Holy Spirit brought me through so many, many, many experiences, experiencings in very fast ways. To get over that, you know, attraction to the form of spirituality, the form of it, the staging of it. So I don't care if some Tibetan master comes in and all the pomp and circumstance and everybody. I don't care about any of that. It's just, what is the content? What is the content? Give us the content. Let's get into phase four here and stupendously stagger the mind. Let us get into this now. So that's phase four. Phase four is you get down to business. And you actually feel like some sort of inner transformation is taking place. There's some tremendous shift, you know, like taking place somehow, somewhere, and it's just staggering. Nothing that can be really expressed in words, or it's so deep. It's deeper than this just superficiality we're dealing with here. The superficial consciousness itself is superficial, but it's deeper than that. It's way deeper than that. And you say, oh my gosh, I'm getting very close. I'm really closing in on no explanation. I'm really closing in on no explanation. So this is terrifying in a way, but not quite that terrifying. It's sort of like jittery. You get jittery. You get the jitters. Now this is good. So what we do in these videos is we want to get the jitters. It's different than before. Before we're trying to avoid the jitters too much, and now we're saying, hey, no, it's not too much. I want the jitters. Come on. But in a positive, sort of organic, natural way, not in a bizarre, weird, threatening way or anything like that. Let the Holy Spirit bring up the clarity that we see. So we expect the Holy Spirit to bring something up that will stagger us in each video. Absolutely. There's no point to it otherwise. No point. If you're spending your time and you're not being staggered by something, there's no point to it. Just wasting your time. And I mean in a very positive spiritual way, staggered. Just like, wow. I call it the good news, the gospel. The gospel is so wonderful that we can't even, which just staggers us, stupendously staggered by the gospel, by the good news. It's like, oh my gosh, everyone's already cured. And if you realize everyone's already cured, you don't need time to sit around waiting for it, do you? You don't need any structure. You don't need any more story. You don't need any more world. You don't need any more body. You don't need any more anything, any storyline. You don't need any more and more belief in existence. Everyone's already cured. So what happens when we get into this? We feel like, whoa. This is startling me at some level. It's like, wow. They just sit quietly, relax, sit quietly. Just say, oh, great, great, this is good. A little bit startled. And then just, as I say, when you get tired sprinting, just slow down to a walk or just a walk. Just walk for a little while. So no, if everyone's already cured, you don't need to experience any existence, actually. And, of course, there's never been any existence, not even an instant of it. Not even one instant of existence. So the burn here is the realization I don't need existence at all. And I'm very close to setting it down. Very, very close to setting it down. Now Jesus tells us that. And when I talk about Jesus of Nazareth, I'm talking about one who knows the truth. Okay? And in spite of all the distortions that have been thrown into it by phase 1, 2, and 3 years, you know, and even stage 4 is not nearly as much, that is for sure. Jesus knows the truth, and he says that when you stop looking for the lack of peace externally and look only within, then you will realize that it's entirely based on your desire for separation from God. Entirely. 100%. And he says when you see that, your will and the will of God together will let it go. Just like that. Again, when we become willing to accept that our lack of peace is entirely coming from within, has nothing to do with what's going on out there. It comes entirely from our desire to be separate from God. So when we stop looking for our lack of peace out there and trying to blame this situation, that situation, this is causing my lack of peace, that's causing my lack of peace, and we realize our lack of peace, we turn within, he says, entirely, without looking outside at all. This is a turning point. This is a turning point that results in realization. And he says, then the world will appear very different to you. It will appear as all one. All one bliss. Cannot really explain or describe it, but this is a turning point. It's entirely based on our desire for separation from God. This is our lack of peace. 100%. It's not coming from out there somewhere, someone else doing something to us, some situation or condition. Ultimately, really, there is no situation or condition whatsoever. There's no such thing as any situation or condition. Perfectly free. How can someone who's perfectly free be in a situation? be in a condition is not possible, is it? And we're not even in a situation or condition now. No one is. So what does that mean? It means everything here is a fake. We're all faking it entirely. We're all trying to, pretending we're separate from God. Striking a pose. We're all just striking a pose. It's all fake. This whole world existence is totally fake. We're striking a pose, constantly striking a pose. But the lack of peace isn't coming from anyone outside of us. It's coming from our own desire for separation. This is gospel from Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. Now, do we have to agree or disagree? That's not the point, is it, in this teaching here, in this way? It's not whether we disagree or disagree. It's a matter of the shock, the staggered mind of hearing this. That's the whole point of it all, is the wow of it. Just hearing it, just wow. Don't take a position on it one way or the other. Just feel the burn, feel the wow. Feel the staggered mindness. Full stop in the staggered mindness. Don't do anything about it. Don't take a position on it. It's like you let a guest in, and you don't interrogate the guest, and just come on in here, sit down, relax. And the guest staggers your mind. Just be quiet. Don't tell them to leave. Don't you leave. Don't tell them to leave. Don't argue with the guest. Don't interrogate the guest. Just say, I invited this guest in with faith, and I believe this is true. So the fact that I'm staggered by this means that I need to move my comfort zone here and get comfortable with this guest. Now the guest knows this. The guest that you've invited in knows this, that you're going to be staggered by the guest. So the guest just sits there quietly too. So all I have to do is look within, and enlightenment dawns then. You see, the cause of your lack of peace is entirely just this desire to be separate from God, which is impossible. So we're dreaming of process, of existence. Existence means process, really. Determinacy. And again, there's never been even an instant of determinacy, never an instant of existence. But to say that there has would mean we are separate from God. So we are so used to striking all these poses and thinking that somehow these poses are connected, like a process. So therefore we're in a situation, or we're in a condition. We're in a condition. Now we think that in order to get out of this condition, we need to strike poses to get out of this condition, which is fine. This is evaporating the continuity fear. Bit by bit by bit by bit, we're striking poses to get out of the condition. But ultimately what we're realizing is, we were never in any condition at all. We've never been in any condition. There's never been any steps taken. I saw this one, and it just is hitting real hard for me. Sometimes your breathing will be a little bit affected. You know, but don't turn it into any emotion. We're not aiming for any emotional state whatsoever, neither intellectual state nor emotional state. No spin on it. Just let the shock, the staggeredness, let it just dissipate, evaporate on its own. Don't try to make it evaporate. Don't try. Just be patient. Don't struggle with the struggle. Emotions occur when you struggle with the struggle. But we're not aiming for an opera here. That is for sure. No drama like that. So don't struggle with the struggle. It's like a sneeze if there's an intense reaction that builds up. Sometimes that happens. You just say, okay, there's an intense reaction, and then that's all it is. I'm not going to struggle with that struggle at all. And when you insist that you're not going to react to this reaction, dissipates. In other words, it doesn't turn into what a huge sneeze or an emotion, for instance. So when you have this staggeredness of the mind, just say, okay, the mind is staggered. Fine, that's, just let it be staggered. It will regain its equilibrium naturally here as it get familiar with this territory. And so when we don't struggle with it, it doesn't turn it into emotions. It doesn't turn into emotionalism. Can say that I have very little emotionalism, and certainly rarely, if ever, experience it in these intense ordeals here. It's mostly just a calm, blank, sort of a neutral mind of just waiting patiently. But I can certainly feel how it would be possible to turn this state condition into emotionalism. Absolutely, if I use my will to do so. But we use our will to not do so. We're not trying to generate emotion or compose some music. Just the opposite. In the past, that's what I would do, you see. Being in the past a musician, and I say, in the past. And what you do is you could use this condition to generate all sorts of emotion and write songs and compose music and all this stuff. Okay, but that short circuits the path to realization, to enlightenment, actually. Been there and done that. Very bad, very much trouble, because you get into the habit of that, terrible habit. One of the most atrocious habits there is trying to generate emotion. It's actually generating emotion out of staggered mindness. It's having no mercy or compassion on yourself. So I don't have a musical instrument. I used to have a house full of musical instruments. Don't anymore. So there's nothing to grab hold of. Before I would think, and then I would sort of shock my mind, stun my mind, stagger myself by, wow, I'm really going into new territory. And then I'd generate that into emotion, and then write songs, compose songs and music that express this new territory, you know, like that. You talk about something that is very ineffectual and makes you go very slow and causes you so much suffering. That's it. So the spiritual path is not about emotion, and neither is it about intellect. You can also turn this into intellectual ferment too. Both emotional, intellectual. You can turn it into artistic stuff. No, we don't do that in Phase 4. We absolutely do not do that. In fact, we avoid that like the plague. Because you can get absolutely lost in music. Completely lost. Freaked out by it, actually. Spend years and years, decades, lives, just pursuing the ramifications, progressions, variations, all this stuff. On just something you just, you know, it just came up and was generated. You had some piece of peak experience that staggered your mind. And then you can use that for a whole lifetime to do riffs off of that, you know. And so that's what you want to avoid, like the plague. That's why I don't hang out with musicians at all. Avoid them like the plague. Because they are a plague, actually. That's the last thing you want to do. Been there and done that and wasted an incredible amount of time. I don't hang around emotional people. At least try not to. Say, look, television is super emotional, isn't it? Super emotional. And people think that this is what we're supposed to be doing. No, that's a defense. That slows you down. It's a delaying tactic. It's a delaying tactic. Okay, that's all it is. You don't really want music. You don't really want music. Believe me. You don't really want it. It's a very nice defense, but you don't really want that. You want liberation from this incredible delusion, misery, suffering, fear, you know, the whole situation. You want liberation from that. You want realization. Jesus says the joy that arises there is beyond anything you could ever imagine. Don't want music, absolutely not. Fourth phase, you're free of that. You know, you feel free of it. There's no attraction. Occasionally I'll listen to a song. I try to keep it very simple. Even kitschy music, you know, actually. It doesn't inspire, doesn't, you know, pull me into it too much at all. Just gospel music or something, you know, just very straightforward, and that's it. Doesn't generate emotions, really. But, so, you don't have to completely, maybe you will stop, that's fine. I have great disinterest in music at this point. I was in someone's house today, and I saw all these cases and stuff. I said, uh-oh, there's a musician here, right? I said, uh-oh. Did I say anything more? No. So all these, you know, mixing boards, you realize, oh, this is a musician. He manages bands or something. They have gigs, all that stuff. I said, ah. Meek, humble, unassuming. I don't know anything. And of course, the serpent, you know, the ego, tells us, oh, you can do both. Tells us, hey, you can do both. Hey, you can do, have your cake and eat it too. Sure, you can do that. And you can do successful sadhana, spiritual path. You can entertain the great good news in both. This is the spiritual pride, the hubris. So what I say, certainly in phase four, you must have the mood of repentance that you have a very severe problem, an extremely severe problem. Just one problem, a continuity problem, but it is devastating. And you have to give it everything you've got. Forget all the rest of the stuff. Forget music, forget art, forget poetry. Even forget most spiritual teachers, you know, teaching, and just forget it. Done with it. The attitude is to feel that I have this and just an incredibly ruinous problem. It's just, I'm afraid of what I am. I'm afraid of reality, afraid of perfection. I have this continuity issue with perfection. And get real serious about it. You don't try and do it all. You don't try to multitask. You don't try to be some great creative person. This is the fourth phase. In the third phase, you may investigate creativity so that you'll be ready to set it down. So there's some people in the third phase who are going through, like I was in the third phase, I went through the very intense creative phase of seeing, just, you know, getting out of my system, so to speak. Intense composing and recording and immersion in music, and it was just horrible. Trying to do, see how good could I be, really? What was my potential in music, really? And thank God, I was not blessed with a really good voice. Just decent. Yeah, you know, so. Because if I had been blessed with a really great, you know, rich, deep voice, oh my gosh, you talk about wasting time. I would have wasted my entire life for sure. For sure. I would have become some big shot singer. Because creatively, I'm able to do anything I want to do. And could just handle the whole situation. But I found out that my voice isn't good enough for that. And I said, oh, thank you, God. What a blessing. What a blessing. The truth is that God, that those who are blessed are those who don't have the skill to be real creative, including how they look, their appearance. So, I was given various appearance flaws that prevented me from being seen as really attractive physically. Okay. Which was a great, great blessing for me. Again, absolutely key, tremendous. So nobody's ever looked at me like I'm attractive or something. Oh, good, that's great. Otherwise, you're going, you know, you could get hooked on being a celebrity. So, it's the ones who are not blessed with all this attractiveness and talent stuff. Those are the fortunate ones. Very fortunate. It's like you're invisible to the world. And then, so then you don't waste your time. You don't waste as much time. People say to me, you know, wow, you should join the church choir or the band or something. You sing so well. It's just, you know, wow. I can sing very well, but my voice is not good. It's fine, but it's not, you know, great voice. And so I said, nah, forget, sorry, no way. Thanks, but no thanks. It's not going to go anywhere. It would not go anywhere. Got better things to do. See, better things to do with life. So instead of moping about, oh, God hasn't blessed me with some great skill, that's a blessing. So I say in my life, I've not been able to do anything, God. I don't have any talents, which is true, really. None of my talents have been good enough to make a living with. I'm always short. I just come up short, no matter what it is. Whatever talent, you know, the people have all these talents. I look at people and say, how come in the world they have that talent and I don't have any talents? And I feel like sometimes, like, you know, deprived, that God hates me. What is God doing to me? Gave me no talents, so to speak. I don't have any talents. But the truth is that that's a supreme blessing, actually, in life. Because there's nowhere to go then but realization. So if you're really blessed, you will find that you really don't have any talents that people seem to value at all. And so you set down your own valuing of the world. You can set down your valuing of the world. The talent I have actually is the spiritual path. That is the talent that I have. Going through phase, you know, 2, 3, now into 4, and some of one I maybe already had. Some of one coming into this life, I am sure I did. Going through, you know, incarnations in Europe and then stretching back to, you know, ancient history. I was certainly exposed to the ideologies of the time, the places I lived in. And, you know, living in Germany, you get, it's highly Lutheran. The Pietist movement, that there were a lot of Pietists and they're like Puritans. It's a split from Lutheranism. You pick up on all this stuff. When you live there, you pick up on all this stuff, and you're considering like there's something wrong. And so that's phase one. Phase one is you're very serious, and you feel like I want to know the truth. I really want to know the truth. And so that becomes more important to you than doing a bunch of stuff in the world, really. More important being famous. You know, I've been famous, and I said, I'd rather know the truth than be famous. You know, I'd rather know the truth than be famous. Well known, you know, somebody who's very well known. I want to know the truth. What is the truth? What is the truth? And then you're searching. That's phase one. Phase two is when you come upon the truth in terms of explanation, that really is, you know, the gospel of explanation, and then you start studying that. It's like, wow, it's something different than I expected, and I'm not really sure what it is, but it's amazing. And phase three is the process of simplifying all of it and also examining your value in the world, the final examination of I did a massive examination of the world, and is it really the world really valuable? Is it really valuable? That's the question. How valuable is the world really? Is it worth my freedom? Is it worth giving up my freedom? Or at least imagining I could? Is it worth dying, suffering, feeling frightened, terrorized? Fear of chaos. Is it worth it? Is it worth it? Because that's the price you pay for this world. The price you pay for believing in this world is believing that you're separate from God, which all actually brings about a continuity problem. So the price you pay for this believing in this world is a severe continuity problem, actually. And the problem is a familiarity problem, and that is not something you can solve by snapping your fingers. This is the problem. So it turns out that the price you pay for believing in this world is a very severe problem. So once I realized that, when I was, I think, about 22 years old, realized it and said, wow, got a severe problem. And just then went to work on it. So if you're in these different phases, just realize that it's going in the right direction. Don't get stuck in them. Don't get stuck. Have faith in the Holy Spirit. Sometimes the situation can seem very tough, very intense. Sometimes your lack of peace is so severe, you know, you just say, wow, this is terrible. But that's driving you inward, driving you to find the real cause of your lack of peace and ultimately liberation and bliss. So if your situation is just intolerable, you know, this is your sodomite, this is your spiritual path, this is your opportunity to say, wait a minute, I better look within here. I better really, to let me turn my attention off the world completely. It does help us. I mean, I just a little while ago I was in such a bad situation, still am, but I felt like it's just impossible. My life is absolutely impossible. The conditions, quote unquote. And I said, I have to be enlightened now. Just have to. And so I went through just an enormous effort and struggle, resulting in finally a breakthrough where I was in this non-dual abidance. But I gradually sort of lost my attention, sort of drifted from that. As I was attracted by some drama of light and dark and all this, you know, of this whole dualistic drama, sort of. So it's, but it shows how when your external circumstances are terrible, it's God helping you. You're being helped to turn within. You're being helped towards the silence, to turn within, to be quietness, right? You're being helped to turn within. Now, it's a pain, right? I mean, you'd rather think, oh, I just want to take it easy. Come on, God, let up on this. And no, God does not. He doesn't let up. It's like, wow. Very intense, fast-tracking. But this is what we signed up for. Keep that in mind. Remember that we signed up for this. So you know you're going to succeed. Say, okay, let's get it done. So we're just looking for the burn here, right? We're just going along here. Patiently. The great thing about this is, I remember in the other phases that I felt like I couldn't, there's no way I could get this breakthroughs or burn. It was impossible, just too difficult. I said, I'm never going to be able to. And now I can get it like every time. So that's a huge progression, tremendous. It's the kind of thing that people just, you know, pray for. Like I just pray for a breakthrough. It may feel like it's, you just never get the breakthroughs you're hoping for. But now it's like, wow. It comes very easy and quickly. Because of the discipline, the ability to effectively full stop in it. Very good fragrance is coming through here. I don't know where it's coming from. It's really something. Oh, well. Speaking of the burn. It actually smells like something's burning somewhere. Something really nice is burning somewhere. There's the burn. And speaking of the burn, we have Jesus of Nazareth providing the burn, helping us. And I tell you now, you are no less limited than God itself. For what you deign to be is, and your imaginings what you imagine is, and what you have imagined is a world of form and of time. So you have taken your spirit, free as the wind, free to dance through all of existence, quote-unquote existence, creation, the terms sort of go back and forth, but actually existence doesn't exist at all. Unlimited by space and time, unlimited by anything you can imagine. You have taken that freedom, and in your playing with it, have imagined that it doesn't exist. Your freedom doesn't exist. So actually, existence is our imagining that reality doesn't exist. That's what existence is. Existence is our imagining. Playing the game of imagining that reality, creation, doesn't exist. And what this course is about, Jesus is referring to A Course in Miracles. Thank you, Jesus, for that. And what this course is about is your coming realization that you are free. And truly, it would be this instant if you could open to the knowing of what I have just said. It would be, why don't we open continuity fear, plain and simple. So in your thinking, think often about time and the value you place on it, and how it is that when you feel fear for the next moment, you are wishing to die. So when you reach a statement like that, it's a shocking statement. Be honest with yourself and feel the shock. Say, that shocks, it just shocked me, staggered my mind. Do not try to figure it out. Do not try to take a position of agreeing or disagreeing with it. You just stay with the shock, the staggeredness, stupendous staggering of the mind. Just stay with that. Don't think about what was said. It hit home. You could feel it hitting home. Just, wow, that hit some note deep within me. Okay, don't do anything. That just, okay. Some chord has been struck deep within. Just let the chord reverberate. So we get the feel of what this chord sounds like. Get the feel of what it sounds like. Without emotion, right? So my breathing is, you know, staggered, as if I'm emotional, but there's no emotionality being expressed at all. But if I hooked it up to emotionality, I could use this as a springboard for all sorts of drama and emotionality. But I said, no. It's like hitting a chord, wham, hit a chord. Just let that be the chord. Don't say, hey, wait a minute. I think I can harmonize and add something to that chord. I feel like this. It gets all emotional then. Don't hit any chord. Once the chord's hit, just sit there. So what's happening is that deep within you agreed with what Jesus said. There's a leap of agreement. And then there's also say, what? Wait a minute, whoa. You know, like that. So this chord of agreement was struck. And now you're saying, oh my gosh, I agree with what was said. This is what's going to happen to me. Just let it settle down of its own accord. Don't try to be some super clever superstar. Just let it. Just be honest. Let it calm down on its own. Just by staying in this full stop mode, it actually helps it calm down. It just allows it to calm down because you're exhibiting confidence in yourself. I'm saying, I don't need to struggle with the struggle. I'm sure that this will calm down. It's like a baby, and the parent, the baby's all freaked, crying. And what does a wise parent do? Remains very calm, and basically to the baby saying, don't worry, I know you're going to calm down soon. I'm not concerned. And the child sees that and says, oh, okay, calms down. Whereas the parent says, what's wrong with you? What's happening? Why are you so upset? Calm down, please calm down. And the baby says, oh my gosh, maybe I won't calm down. The parent thinks I might not calm down, and then it makes it worse. So you'd be like a wise parent. You say, don't worry, you'll calm down soon. I'm sure of it. But don't force it. Don't force it. What a guru does, a great sage does, is exude this confidence, which says to everybody, don't worry. You're already, all of you are already cured. It's just a matter of accepting it. You don't need any time, as Jesus is saying. You could realize at this instant, you don't need any time. So they just exude that confidence. You say, you're going to get it. I'm positive. You'll get it soon. Jesus exudes this confidence. He always has this attitude of, you can get it right now. And if you don't get it right now, you're going to get it really soon. And I'm sure you're going to succeed at this. Always he has this attitude. Now, this is better than not, right? It doesn't mean that you're going to get it real quickly. It does, but it certainly helps speed things up. It's the right attitude to have. In other words, it still has taken a long time. I'm still working on it. And Jesus has been saying that. He's been saying that for 36 years, But that's the right attitude. Calms you down. Saying, I can get this. Jesus says, I'll be able to get it, so I'm not worried, I'll get it. And the same hand realizing we have a very severe problem, a continuity problem. Quite severe, actually. Now you can feel when this reaction just tends to drop off, like a baby crying, and then they start, the emotion seems to pass, and they stop crying, and it's gone, like that. Like a cloud passing, dark cloud passing or something. Sometimes you have to give it extra time. So that's why it's really important to give yourself unlimited time when you practice. Don't rush it. The best is open-ended. You don't have any particular time limit. Here, I'll even go over 2 hours. I'll go 3 if I have to. just however long. If I do that, I go over to, I have to split it into two parts, but sometimes I'll do that, I'll split it into two parts. So this is the secret, is keep it open-ended so that you allow yourself to have some severe reaction, some severely staggered mind. And you're giving yourself enough time to relax into that and get comfortable with it, get familiar. When I mean comfortable, I mean familiar. I don't mean the type of body comfort, like, oh, I'm sitting in a comfortable chair. Not like that. I mean, there's a holistically comfort zone of saying, hey, this territory is okay. I feel okay with this territory. In other words, I'm not scared of this territory. It feels like home to me. It's like that. So I say comfort zone, I don't mean physical comfort. I mean spiritual feeling of, hey, this sort of feels like home. I feel this, I'm okay here. I get the lay of the land. I'm not startled, I'm not terrified, I'm not frightened. This is part of my territory now. Like that. That's what I mean by comfort zone. It's like a young person exploring where they live, and they go further and further. Even cats do that, you know. Cats stay around the home when they're young, and they start going across the street, neighbor's yard. They start going further and further. Gradually, we tend to branch out and look, discover more and more territory, and until we feel comfortable. I feel comfortable going to this place and that place and that place. But this is like spiritual territory that we're covering here. Way more intense. You can go around the whole world exploring all sorts of territories, but that's nothing in compared to the intensity of these spiritual recognitions. I remember my dad, that's what my dad did. Went to almost every place in the country in the world. But he towards the end of his sojourn here, he told me, hey, you're not going to find it out there. You're not going to find it. You're not going to find it out there. It's within. It's within. That's what he told me. So I took his advice. I said, hey, you know, I trust what he said. So I never traveled. I haven't traveled. I mean, just when I was young, I traveled a little bit with the family. And I took one trip to Japan in Hong Kong, Taiwan, Thailand. When I was about 19 years old, or 18 or 19, something like that. Other than that, nothing. Because I know it's a waste of time. If anybody was going to find it was my dad, he would have found it. He was a fantastic traveler and an explorer, actually. He was a professional explorer, great explorer. Explored the Yucatan Peninsula, Guatemala, rediscovered the temple, one of the temples there, and traveled through across equatorial Africa, and all, you know, hiked through it, all sorts of stuff. And so, if anyone was going to find it, he was going to find it. That is for sure. He would go anywhere, climb any mountain, and he did. He went to all these spiritual places around the world, and he said, hey, it's not out there. It's within. So thank you. Thank you, Dad. Thank you for that. I had to go through my journey of subtler stuff, subtler valuing. It's not there either. In other words, the subtler forms of spirituality, the goddess forms and all that kind of stuff. And that's not it either. You know, prettier spirituality. You could put it prettier, more attractive, superficially. That's not it. That's not it. So we can be helped if we listen to the collective. I say this as a collective thing in some way, because we can learn from others who have done all this to say, hey, you know what, it's not there. You're not going to find it there. Believe me. And if we trust them, they're trustworthy. If they're really trusted, and we can accept it. Say, okay, I'm not going to even waste my time on that. I believe what you're saying. So if you really are good at that, like Srina Sargadatta Maharaj went to this guru, he'd never met this guru in his life. So his friend introduced him, and the guru just said, do this, who am I, or some I am, or something, follow the I am, and that's all you need to do. And so he said, I trusted the guru, I believe what he said was true, that's all I need to do, so that's all I did. I just started doing it, and I just kept doing it, and nothing else. And what was it, 4 years or something, he was enlightened. See, this is a super great example of how, in trusting, you can be helped by others, actually. If you're ready and willing to be helped. And don't want to learn it on your own, do it on everything on your own. No, I want to travel to and discover it on my own. No, don't waste time, forget it. If it's not there, then you're not going to find it there. Why waste time? So this is something that bothers me in the world. I find the younger generation tends to, that always does this way, to discount the previous generations, what they've discovered, and that's not smart at all. That's stupid. It's arrogant. So I try to listen to, you know, those who have come before me with wisdom and said, you know, help me save time. Tried to. It's not always easy. But I think with the advent of the internet, that there's so many young people who think they know it all. They're so smart. They say, oh, I can just look anything up on the internet and I'm better, you know, I can Google better than you can, so I'm smarter than you, which is ridiculous. Okay, absolutely ridiculous. The internet is very suspect in many ways, actually. It's a tool. You have to use it very carefully. And certainly it does not equate to wisdom. It certainly, most certainly doesn't. But there's this feeling like, well, you didn't have the internet, you know, so how can you be smart? This is the tragedy of the times. This is so prevalent. You know, you didn't have smartphones, you didn't have the internet, so how can you work? You can't be smart. Yeah, which is ludicrous. One might say that because we didn't have the internet and smartphones, we're probably a lot smarter, actually. Less distraction. But if you're very intuitive and savvy and guided by the Holy Spirit, the internet can be used to accelerate your path also. It can be used that way. I've certainly used the internet to a tremendous extent to help me out with valuing of the world and getting reports from other places where I'm viewing stuff. I say, wow, now I don't have to do that. Wow, now I don't have to do that. Oh, so that's what that's about. Okay, I'm no longer interested in that. You know, it's great. It can be very helpful if you know how to use it properly. Things is to realize there's nothing to value here in this world. This world doesn't have anything valuable at all. Living in like a polyglot culture like the Bay Area of California, one of the benefits is you realize that people aren't of any value whatsoever in terms of a person, a personality like that, a human person is of no value. Everyone's all messed, completely messed up. All races, all cultures, all everything. We have everything here in the Bay Area. And I was standing next to someone from China in the Home Depot. In fact, most of the people were Chinese in there. I was in China. And if I said something to him, I said, why don't they hire more cashiers? Or it's ridiculous. And he looked at me and smiled and says, yeah, I mean, it's incredible, isn't it? You know, and I realized, you know, he's just the same as everybody else. We're all just the same, which is no value in this world. This world has no value whatsoever. Bodies have no value. Whatever the body is doesn't have any value whatsoever. I mean, the Bay Area is like a third world place in a lot of ways. It's amazing. You have now huge thriving communities, even cities, of all sorts of different ethnic people. A lot of them from Asia, a lot of them Hispanic, yeah. But Indian too. I mean, there's all over. Russians, all sorts of Russians all over the place. And so you realize there's no great people anywhere. There's no great people anywhere at all. Everyone's messed up, totally messed up. You don't have to travel the world. You can just go outside your door and, you know, go to the market and just say, wow. Sometimes going to the market late, it's like going to the Rocky Horror Show or something. It's like, I think, you know, it's like people who don't want to be seen, the troglodytes or the you know, they're really, they realize they're kind of out of whack. They go to the market late at night, you know, and they see him like, oh God. He's like, oh, I didn't want anyone to be here, you know, while I was shopping. You know? It's funny. It's like I kind of okay, you know, because they don't want to be seen. They don't want to be seen. They're going, you know, they're going through, you know, intense stuff. I understand. I used to go to the market late at night. I still do. I'm still going through intense stuff, but in a positive way. But I used to go late to market, like, too. I was just like, wow, this is too intense. I'm really under too much, you know, intensity here. And I don't really want people to see me. Yeah, like that. Interruption. Unpleasant interruption. So you realize, wow, so many people are messed up, so many on drugs and all sorts of stuff, wow. And then during the day, there's the people who want to be seen. They're there because they want to make sure everyone sees them, how great they look. Like that. What a world, huh? Not answering my phone. I get chastised for not answering my phone. Well, don't have to answer a phone. I don't even have my phone with me. I don't think, no, I did not. How about that? Another thing I hate is carrying identity. Why do I need to carry identity? It's the stupidest thing. I can't stand it. Why do I need to identify myself? Why do I need to identify myself? It's ridiculous. You think about it, it's like, what a bizarre world we live in. Can I see your identity? Who wants to live in a world where you gotta carry identity and identify yourself to who? You know, it just blows my mind. I'm a spirit. I'm a spirit, that's what I am. So the idea of carrying identification papers, mandatory, you know, it's mandatory. You're not supposed to go out of your house without identification papers. That is crazy, absolutely crazy. All sorts of people demanding that you prove that you, what, exist or something, I don't know. The stuff I get is just bizarre. Bizarre world. And bizarreness is not my friend at all. I don't like bizarreness. And the world is is totally bizarre. If because it's a belief in a world that doesn't exist, how bizarre is that? We have this massive belief system that there's a world, but it doesn't exist. It doesn't even exist. There's no world at all. Well, we have the situation of all this, everyone believing that there's a world, that there's existence, and what to do about it, how to get rid of it. You know, duality is like saying, how do I get rid of existence? You know, dualistic realization is the belief, like, okay, how do I get rid of existence? Or say, well, no, existence is okay, it's fine, no problem. That's duality too. The real truth is there is no existence. There's no one experiencing, there's only experience. The question of, well, how do we experience is a wrong question. We don't experience. It's direct. There is no subject-object of experiencing, actually. We can't explain it. And we do have dualistic teachers who are very talented and very charismatic, but they're dualistic. Don't want that. We have to go past that. So, the burn has died down a little bit now, you see. So, again, you think, wow, we didn't do much. Just one tremendous shock, you know, is great progress. It's great progress. And how do you get this progress in any other way, actually? You have to be honest and actually let it happen, experience it. And then don't push too hard, because maybe you'll be too frightened the next time, you know, so okay. Good enough for now, and we'll take a little break. Take a little break, and it's still reverberating. Still reverberating. So just stay patient, low key, meek, humble, unassuming. Mood of repentance, meek, humble, unassuming. Mood of repentance, meaning I have a very severe problem. And I just have to focus on that. Okay. Very great. That's it.